So welcome back, friends. So you have already seen this diagram, this waveform in the previous video, and we have also seen that how the colors are non-separable. You cannot separate a red, green, and a blue completely. Okay, and we have also seen that red, green, blue are called as primary colors. Okay, so to moving ahead with this, the next thing is, we were telling that we could produce n number of different colors when we mix these three colors, along with that by varying the wavelength, plus also by negating the colors. So today we will see how this could be done. So in order to study that, we'll just have a look at this diagram, wherein the first diagram, in this the first diagram wherein we have mixed all the lights or mixed various colors of light so that we could obtain the secondary lights. So remember, friends, we are mixing the primary colors to obtain the secondary colors. So as you can observe in this diagram, when we mix your red and blue, when the red and the blue are mixed, we get a new color called as magenta, which is something like pink, right? And when we mix our green and blue, when the green and blue are mixed, we get a new color called as cyan, C-Y-A-N. Okay, and when you mix red and green, you get one more color called as yellow. So what we have done now, we are primarily mixing these three primaries and we are getting a secondary, which is opposite of the primary color. And the intensities would produce something like a what you can see here. Now, when we mix all these three colors, what you get is, you would be getting a white light. You can observe here at the center, when you have mixed all the three colors, the red, green and blue in proper proportions, you can see that a third, you are getting a white color. So this is in your first part of the diagram, what you can see. Now, going ahead, that is, one second. So I was speaking of this part of the diagram. Fine. Now, moving ahead, we'll move to the next thing, which is your below the next diagram, which you can observe here. So whatever you can see in the 6.4b, that is this diagram, you can see here, what we have done here is, we have negated the pigments. It is nothing but it is a mixture of pigments. That is, we try to differentiate between the primary colors and the pigments. Now, how this could be done? It is nothing but it is the subtract or absorbs of a primary color. Or you can say, it is nothing but what a reflection or transmission has been done. Therefore, you can see the primary colors of the pigments are magenta, cyan, yellow. Right? So, what we have got now, the pigments, that is whatever you have got after mixing, is nothing but your magenta, cyan, and yellow. Now, when you mix these three colors in proper combination, when the three pigment colors are mixed, you get something which with its opposite primary. Like say, for example, it produces a black color. You can observe here, when we have mixed all the three colors, that is whatever, what you have got here, you have got cyan, the same cyan you are using here, you have got here yellow, the same yellow you are using here, you have got your magenta, the same magenta you are using here, right? And when you mix them at proper proportion, here you had got a white light, white color, and here you have got a black color. That is the opposite of the previous one, right, friends? Now, what is happening here? So, to make you understand with this, we will just try to see one more simple example, right? One second. Okay, so to make you understand how this mixture is done, we'll take a simple example of your color television. Okay, so if you remember, friends, in the earlier days, or you might have also seen, we had something, televisions which were dome shaped, something like this, right? If you remember, we had a dome shaped television like this, which were called as CRT. These television sets were called as CRT television sets, which stands for cathode ray tube color televisions. There was also black and white as well, but as we are discussing of color image processing, we'll consider them as the color TV. Now, this cathode ray tube or CRT is composed usually of large array of triangular dot patterns of electron sensitive phosphor. So what it will be having is, it will be having some triangular like this, which would be having a dotted pattern, and this triangular dotted pattern is made up of your phosphor. Using phosphor they do it. Now what happens here in this, these small dots which are there in the triad would be excited, and when they are excited they would produce a light, and these light will be one of the primary colors. That means what would happen, an electron beam would come and hit these dots. When these dots are hit, then you can see that the particular a particular primary color is produced. Now what is a particular primary color? A particular primary color would be R or G or B. Any one of this particular primary color would be produced. Now how this is done? Now the intensity of the emitting phosphor dots is usually modified with the help of the electron gun which is inside the tube. Then using that, it will be generating a corresponding red energy as seen by the TV camera. Similar to this, we will be also having the green and blue phosphor dots, which are again modulated in the same manner. So what we did, we told you that if a ray hits here, what would be happening? If a ray hits here, if it's a red phosphor, then it would emit what now? A red light. If it's a green phosphor, what it would do? It would emit a green light. If it's a blue phosphor, what it would do? It would emit a blue light. So that means we'll be using these three colors. Then what we do? These three colors are added together and would be received by the cones in our eye, which is nothing but the sensors in our eye. So finally, what was the last thing now? Till now we discussed it is an image, but what you actually see in your television? You see your videos. Then what we used to do is, whatever the images or whatever the images were produced, these were run at a high speed, like say for somewhere around 30 images per second, and then we would create an illusion like a video. You would feel that a video is running, but it is nothing but an image or a set of images which are run at a high speed. Now this was all we discussed regarding your CRT TV, that is nothing but your cathode ray tube color television. But what we have in today's world, we have all our flat panels, which are nothing but something like this. A flat TV would be there, which is being replaced by your CRT, right? So what is happening here then? Has the technology changed drastically, or has the things whatever happening in CRT and LCD have changed? Yeah, surely they have changed, but not to the major extent. That is, we have a similar technology using the same principle. The principle would remain the same. That is nothing but there we would generate three colors, which are nothing but your R, G and B, by hitting them with the electron. Similarly, here we will be generating three subpixels, which are nothing but your R, G and B subpixels, which would generate a single color pixel. So that means what now? Your LCD, what it would do, it will use the properties of polarized light to pass or block the light through the LCD screen. So in the case of an active matrix display technology, we would use your TFTs. TFT stands for thin film transistors, which would produce a proper signal to address each pixel on the screen. So similar to this, what would be having finally is, the individual cells would be addressed in the same manner how it was done in your CRTs. Then the individual pixel triad coordinate, why we are calling it a triad, because it is a triangle, would be all the individual pixels inside a triad would be coordinated, and we would form a digital display. So I hope it is clear, friends. The small difference there was what? It was being hit by a, in CRT it was being hit by electron tube, but here we will be using your TFTs, that is thin film transistors, and this would give you a proper address of the pixel on the screen, and that particular pixel would be displayed. Okay, so this is one thing. Now another major thing, or another major characteristics which we need to understand, is nothing but your brightness, hue and saturation. That is brightness, hue is nothing but It is HUE. Hue is nothing but HUE. So one is brightness, another one is hue, and the third one is your saturation. So as we discussed in the earlier section, brightness is specially considered with your achromatic notations, and we can say in general brightness is concerned to the intensity. So you can just remember this much, friends. Brightness is concerned to intensity, and hue is something which is considered with the wavelength, and this wavelength which is obtained when you do a mixture of various light waves. So you can say hue is nothing but it represents a color which is pursued by the observer. That is, whatever the color the observer is able to see, that is nothing but it is a hue. And how do you obtain this hue? It is nothing but the dominant wavelength which is obtained by mixing your various light waves. Now, going forward, the next very important thing we have is saturation. So saturation is nothing but it is the purity or the amount of white light which is mixed with the hue. So remember, friends, saturation and hue are concerned. Saturation is something which is obtained after getting hue. So that means, what is saturation now? Whatever the white light is there, that white light plus hue is nothing but your saturation. That's all. Okay. Now, when we speak of pure spectrum colors, we say that they are fully saturated. Colors such as pink, lavender are less saturated. That is, the degree of saturation is inversely proportional to the amount of white light being added. If I add more white light, then I would be getting a different color. Like, say for example, I have a red, and if you go on adding white into it, you get a pink, something like that. And if we have a violet, and if you go on adding white into it, you will be getting a color called as lavender. Okay, now this hue and saturation together are called as chromacity. So remember this, friends, hue along with your saturation, when we mix these two together, we call it as chromacity. Similarly, the whatever the amount of lights we mix, which are the lights lights or colors we are mixing, it is red, green and blue. So amount of red, green and blue are added, they are called as tri-stimulus values. Why tri? Because they are three. And why stimulus? Because they are stimulating or producing a different color. Now, these tri-stimulus values are given by your X, Y and Z. So they are given by X, Y and Z. So X, you can say it is red, Y you can say it is blue, and Z you can say black. So when you go on adding these three colors with proper intensities, we call them as tri-stimulus values. Right, friends? Okay. Now, next very important thing is, now how this color is obtained? This color is specified by using this trichromatic coefficients, which are defined by something like this. That is, small x is equal to x plus y plus z divided by I'm redoing it. It is nothing but So this we are speaking of your tri-stimulus coefficient. So this trichromatic coefficients are given by using small x, which is given by small x is equal to capital X plus capital Y plus capital Z. And whatever you are getting here, that is capital X, capital Y, this is divided by a capital X, something like this. So you can say that X, small x is equal to X, capital X, which is here, you can consider as red. This is equal to red plus green plus blue. Similarly, you can do it for next color, which is green. So if I consider Y as green, small y is equal to, it is given by Y, capital Y divided by capital X plus capital Y plus capital Z. So this is again your red, green and blue. Similarly, you can do it for small z as well. We can do the same thing for small z as well. Okay, friends. So this is how you would be doing mixing your various colors, and you would get a new coefficient which is called as trichromatic coefficient. Okay, now in order to understand this trichromatic coefficients, we need to go to next diagram, which is we need to go to next slide, which would look something like this. So this diagram, whatever you can see here, it is called as trichromacity diagram. Now what is this trichromacity diagram? See, trichromacity diagram is nothing but it is a function of your red and green. So whatever you can see on the x-axis, we consider x-axis as red axis. Whatever you can see on the y-axis, we consider it as a green axis. Now when you mix this red and green, or whatever point you plot on this diagram, on this whole scale, then you would be getting a corresponding blue. Like say for example, I am at this position, say somewhere here, and I am at this position in the y, then I get a particular color here. Okay, similarly, if I am at this position and I am at some this position here, then where they intersect at this point, I'll get a another color, a different color. In this way, when you go on marking different points, you will be getting different colors. So that means, for example, whatever you can see here, the green is approximately 62% in this whole diagram. If you can see here, the green is somewhere around 62%, the red is somewhere around 25%, and the blue is somewhere around only 13%. Okay, now whatever the composition of this spectrum colors you are seeing, it ranges from violet, which is 380 nanometers, to red, which is 780 nanometers, as we can be in, as it can be seen in this tongue shaped chromatic diagram. You can see here the shape of this diagram is in the form of a tongue. Okay, now how do you understand that where is my, how can I cover my entire color, how I can take my entire, what is the entire range of the whole colors which I can observe or which I can obtain? Then that could be done with the help of your three points, that is three given colors in the chromatic diagram. So that could be done by simply drawing or connecting the lines to each of these three colored points. Then the result, whatever you get, is a triangle which you can see in the slide, and any color on the boundary or outside the triangle can be produced by various combinations of the three colors. If you want to produce any color, you can produce it by combining three colors. Now a triangle, whatever you can see here, it is having three fixed colors, and it cannot enclose the complete color region. So that is why you can see some colors are left out, some colors would be left out, and whatever you can see here, it is called as color gamut. Whatever the triangle you can see inside the tongue diagram, it is called as color gamut. Okay, now the boundary of this color gamut is irregular. Because why it is irregular? Because the color printing is a combination of additive as well as subtractive color mixing. So therefore a process which is very difficult to control. You cannot easily control this whole process, which would be very difficult to do it on a monitor. So therefore the color gamut is a bit irregular. Irregular in the aspect that what color would be obtained, that is irregular, that's all. Okay, so this is all regarding your color basics, friends, how the color image has it will be processed and what could be done. So this is color fundamentals, whatever we have covered today. So please go through both the videos, both are very important. And if you have any doubts in these videos, you can just call or WhatsApp me on my number, and I'm always ready to help you. Okay, so thank you for watching. Please come up with any doubts if you have. Okay, thank you. We'll again meet in the next class to cover the next topic, which is color models. Okay, see you.